Hello, everyone, and welcome to today's webinar, McMaster University Continuing Education, Caregiving Essentials. Anyone can become a caregiver advocate. Today's webinar is being recorded for use by Caregiving Essentials participants. My name is Erin, and I'll be your host on behalf of McMaster Continuing Education. Today, I'm joined by our facilitators, Donna Thomson and Maggie Keresteci. I'd like to introduce to you Donna Thomson. She is a caregiver and the co-author of The Unexpected Journey of Caring, as well as the author of The Four Walls of My Freedom. Donna is a facilitator of Caregiving Essentials and Infection Prevention and Control for Caregivers and Families, our free online courses for family caregivers. And I'd like to introduce to you Maggie Keresteci. Maggie is the executive producer of Canadian Association for Health Services and Policy Research. She's also a family caregiver and leader in Canadian family caregiver advocacy. And now, Donna, I'll hand things over to you.
Thank you so much, Erin. And hi, Maggie. I am just delighted to be here today. We're going to have a super fun conversation about advocacy. You know, Maggie, I wanted to begin by asking you if you can remember the very first time you ever advocated for a family member, in a healthcare context.
So first of all, I'm just so delighted to be here. I'm delighted to be here with you. I'm thrilled to be here with people that have been supportive of me through my journey of caregiving, and I'm really excited about having a conversation today. You know, when I think back to when I began advocating, our family story is one of what happens in a fragmented system. And it's a story about what happens when we lose sight of our North Star, what happens when we talk about having a patient-centered system, when what we really mean is we have a provider-centered one. It's people-centered when it's convenient. You know, as you know, I'm a caregiver for my mom now who lives with me and for my sister. But, you know, to answer your question, I'd like to take you back to the beginning of my journey, which was really when I was a caregiver to my dad. And I was a very young carer then. And one of the things I think about, so this is many decades ago, and I am so grateful for the experience of being his caregiver. For the year before he died. He was 49 when he died, very young man.
Yeah.
And I was able to care for him in the year before he died. He wanted to die at home, and that's what we were able to do. And I think about it often because of how it shaped who I am. It mm-hmm. shaped my choice of career. It shaped how I've lived my life. And it shaped my advocacy. I'll start by just telling you, so I'm Irish, and my dad was the ultimate Irish storyteller. As a child, I don't recall a single night at home when we didn't share stories. And when his stories didn't infuse my dreams as a child. So that's, I tell that because it's part of why I believe so strongly in the importance of our stories and the insights that are in those stories. So when my dad got sick, so again, he was 48 at the time, and I was thrown into this role of being a young caregiver when he unexpectedly got sick. So, you know, he was a very active man. He was a bagpiper. He used to ski with me and was very, very active. And then all of a sudden, He started becoming what I'll call disoriented, for lack of a better word. And we thought maybe he'd had a stroke. Took him to the hospital, and it turned out that what he had was a kidney cancer that had already spread to his brain. But we didn't find that out for some time. And there's a couple of parts of the story that I want to talk about today because they relate to my journey as an advocate. So, you know, this is several decades ago. And when the he was admitted then to neurology and then to neurosurgery. And when the surgeon found out what was wrong with my dad, his secretary called me, his secretary, not him, and told me on the phone that my dad was going to die.
Oh my gosh.
And that there was nothing that they could do for him. And that I had to come and get him now because they needed the bed for someone who would benefit from surgery.
Oh.
I got to tell you, Donna, so all of these things, first of all, I was, this is going to sound funny in some ways. I was making chicken soup at the time for my mom, making chicken soup. And so to this day, so this is, you know, many years ago, to this day, I cannot eat chicken noodle soup.
Yeah.
Because I so associate it, right? But I want to talk to you a little bit about why this was such a beautiful and difficult year. So my parents had raised me to believe that my voice was important and to believe that I had agency. But in this experience, as my dad's caregiver, as a young person, I had no agency. So I was his full-time caregiver. I knew him very well. We were very, very close. Yet I was overlooked. I was ignored. I was ridiculed. And I was looked down on because I was a child. It's funny, you know, it's been years ago and I still get emotional when I think about this. So I was pushed aside literally and figuratively, yet I knew him and his needs better than any healthcare provider we encountered. And I know in my heart of hearts that had I been listened to, I could have helped them to provide him really good care. Mm-hmm. We did eventually find an oncologist who was very supportive. But in that year, I had to fight for every dose of pain medicine we got at home. I had to fight to get him a bed and equipment. And I had to do it all in not having a formal role. Mm. I was just that voice that kept on annoying people. And the reason I talk about that experience with my dad is, you know, fast forward to the last few years, and being the carer for my sister. And here's the epiphany for me, is that while we use new terms, and we have patient experience offices in every hospital, which we didn't have then, and while we tell patient stories at the beginning of every board meeting, which we didn't do then, but in fact, very little has changed since my experience with my dad, right? And, you know, our family's experience still speaks to a system that's broken, where the system itself is the center of care and planning, not the patient, and certainly not the family or the caregiver.
Mm-hmm.
Sorry for taking so long to tell that story, but, you know, it's just where it began. And there's been such a common thread all the way through. My daughter likes to call me a serial caregiver. So, you know, I cared for my dad. I went on to care for my husband, who I don't talk about that very often because it's still quite painful. And then, you know, to my sister and my mom now, and those common threads that have woven all the way through it, mm-hmm. Have been a real lesson to me in why advocacy matters.
Mm-hmm. You know, it's remarkable that you told that story because my father had three strokes and lived with us, me and my mom. My sister was away at school, but he lived with us and he died at 54. And I was a teenager at home helping my mom to look after him. And yeah, I'm a serial caregiver too. And the thing that strikes me is that we become advocates as part of who we are as caregivers, as our caregiver identity evolves and we become more skilled and more confident and more competent in our role with lots of family members over the years.
Yeah.
And, but we build on our experiences, and it's so interesting to me that you, as a teenager, as a young person, doing this job, doing this care work at home, you were completely overlooked, and that in itself was a learning opportunity in a way for you to, as part of, as it was a building block, an important building block of your advocacy learning.
Yeah, I mean, absolutely.
Yeah, and I would say that's very true for me too. I would venture to say that probably most people listening today are thinking maybe about their very first advocacy experiences, and maybe those first experiences were what we consider failures.
Right.
Failure to be heard, the failure to have agency, the failure of the system to listen to us and support us. So then what do we do about that? Where is the turning point where you discovered your agency, Maggie?
So that's a great question, Donna. I think what the experience with my dad left me with at the time. So this is, you know, again, being young. I remember at the time after he died, feeling guilty and that I couldn't do more. And then I remember coming to a place where I thought, no, I'm going to persist and I'm going to bow to myself that I will never allow my voice to be silenced again. Mm-hmm. And became such a key part of who I am and who I became as an adult, was that recognition that my voice was important for different reasons, but that I would not let it ever be quieted again. And that I would always find a way to make sure that it was heard. You know what, when I think about how I grew into advocacy, Beverly Pomeroy uses a term that I really like, and it's that I fell into advocacy.
Yes.
Right. You know,
we fall into caregiving.
Right? Exactly. Yeah. And I think of it that way. I think I felt so strongly that in my heart of hearts, knowing that I did all that I could to care for him, that I could have done more had I been able to make my voice heard. And as I say, for me, the real epiphany was in recognizing that no matter how much we talk about patient experience and no matter how much we talk about the institutions that we put in place, fundamentally, we still depend on the advocacy of individuals and caregivers to speak up on behalf of the people they're caring for. I always think of advocacy as this continuum. And there are some days when most I can do is advocate for the nurse to come from home care for my sister. It's all I can manage. And other days I feel like I'm part of a big A advocacy where we're trying to shape the system in a different way. Mm-hmm. And I think all of those are good. All of those are okay. You know, I'd be interested what people on the line think of this, but, you know, I think we sometimes get into the trap of thinking that advocacy has to be about system change and has to be about, big change. And it doesn't. Advocacy, right? Advocacy can be those one-on-one little things we do.
Yeah. Oh, yes, absolutely. We can advocate within our immediate family. I mean, it can be tiny and very personal. I just want to share some of what's happening in the chat too. And Sarah Pott writes, your story of caregiving, Maggie, reminds me of threads in a woven fabric. Mm. And you know, yes, we become, you know, the weaving becomes tighter and we become like a safety net for our family, for our person that we're caring for. And Sharon Anderson has also shared, a wonderful paper, and she's put the link in there, a paper by Nora Keating and Janet Fast, who are great Canadian academics in the field of caregiving. Jana Bowman writes, I advocate with the barista who makes my coffee.
I love it, Jana.
Like that in our lives, don't we? Commiserating about advocacy. Right. And what should I do and what should I say or what should I have said? Sarah Kaplan writes, you are correct. Advocacy can look different depending on what you can do and what the needs are.
Right.
And it's important to acknowledge that advocacy makes caregivers war weary.
Yes. You know, it's really interesting. I don't know if Sue's on the chat or not, but I often use a line from her first book, Bird's Eye View, where she talks about the fact that advocacy, everyone has a different view and different capacity when it comes to advocacy. And for some people, it might mean, you know, for me, it depends on the day and it depends on what else is going on in my life, right? It might mean fundraising, it might mean lobbying government, or it might mean lobbying that my sister gets a pillow that she needs, right?
Yeah.
You know, it might mean advocating that someone uses her name instead of her room number when they're calling her. And I found that, you know, when I read this portion in Sue's book, she talks about the fact that there's no one right way to advocate. And that the most important thing is that you find your right way. Mm-hmm. And you find the way that matches your, not just your personality, but, you know, your time, the space that you're in at the time, how your comfort level. So I often think of that when I'm thinking about how we define advocacy and how we understand advocacy.
Sue, you wrote a blog post recently that I wanted to talk about today, because we're going to talk in a minute about, of course, the wins and the benefits of advocating within different healthcare settings, including home, hospital, long-term care, assisted living, etc. But and with healthcare professionals, of course. But Sue, you wrote last week a blog post about the risks of advocacy, the personal risks of advocacy. And I would love for you to describe to us some of the risks that you have taken and how those risks have impacted you personally. Because we're talking in a way about advocacy as if it's easy, and it is not easy.
It's not.
It's not without personal risk. So Sue, can you unmute yourself and join our conversation?
Sure. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, it's nice to see you both and everyone in the chat. I recognize a whole bunch of names.
I know.
We're a tight group, eh? Yeah. Well, we take care of each other. This is part of taking care of each other, because as I wrote in that essay, caregiving and advocacy is lonely work. It can be very, very lonely work. And in fact, what you're speaking up about, whether it's at point of care with someone you love or with the bigger system, is against the status quo. And nobody wants to hear that. Like, you are the dissenting one. And as patients and caregivers, when we talk about fighting the system, I mean, normally I don't like war metaphors and stuff in healthcare, but I can tell you that is what it feels like, because it feels as if everybody is against you except for our peers, which that's the importance of building a community, I think, when you're in it for the long haul.
Yeah, it's so true. You know, every time I have advocated for my family members and I'm thinking especially for our son Nicholas, who has very high needs and is medically complex, and or for my mother, who was needed advocacy, and because she was often working at odds against me and my sister, and we're trying to advocate to keep her safe when she did not appreciate personal risks very well at all. But, you know, every time that I have advocated for them in the, well, all my adult life that I've been a caregiver, I have felt uncomfortable every single time. I have felt a sense of unease.
Right.
And I've always worried too that the care from healthcare professionals in some way could be negatively impacted by my advocacy. I was afraid to say something that might upset the boat so much that they would either kick them out or they would withdraw some level of care. And Sue, I know you have your hand up. I'm not sure exactly why you can't turn your camera.
I know.
On.
Well, it's probably,
I don't know, but
it's
we
probably
can
just
hear
as
you.
Well. I'm not really prepared.
Oh, nonsense. I wish we could see you, but oh well. We know, can hear you.
So. I think some of this, I wrote another piece and I talked to a bunch of advanced practice nursing students actually about advocacy and advocating for my son who has Down syndrome. And what I realized is I'm a very reluctant advocate.
You wouldn't know it from all the advocacy that you do.
My own personality. There I am.
Oh, there we are.
You know, my own personality is I'm a people pleaser. I like to fly under the radar. I'm an introvert. I hate conflict. And all those things are the opposite of what you need when you're an advocate. So I think a lot of us caregivers, and I'm making an assumption here, are quite soft people and we're big-hearted because we care for other people. As you said, you're a serial caregiver. That's part of your personality. So within that, having to speak up against, you know, the big system, the status quo, to not be liked. There's plenty of people that do not like us when we speak up. Like I wrote the piece. I don't want to dissuade people because it's something that we have to do, but also we get a lot of pressure to do it on behalf of our communities. Right. And the reason I wrote it is because I think that's not fair. And I think that we need allies to help us who are health professionals who work in the system. Yeah. And I've had so many physicians and nurses and social workers say to me, but you have to speak up and advocate. And my question to them is, well, why don't you help me? I need help doing this. I'm already stressed out because my kid is sick because I'm sick. Like, we need to do this together. We can't keep doing this alone because it's just a recipe for burnout.
Yeah.
I think we also have to remember there's a chance that when we put the expectation on caregivers and patients that they're going to be advocates, they become responsible for their care in an inappropriate way. And accountability and responsibility shifts to the patient and caregiver as opposed and removed from healthcare providers at times, right? So we have to be careful we don't develop the mentality that if patients and caregivers aren't part of the solution, they're part of the problem. Because as you say, it's not in everybody's makeup to be doing this. And people worry about how it's going to affect their loved one's care or how it's going to affect their job or any number of things. I mean, Sue, when you talk about the impacts on your professional life, like that's a very real thing.
Yeah. Holy cow. Maybe you can describe what we're talking about there, Sue, for people who haven't read your blog post.
I thought to myself, okay, I've been outside the system trying to make change. I'll get a job inside the system and see what I can do. So I worked for a children's hospital in family center care for a number of years. And what ended up happening is, you know, they tried to close my son's Down syndrome clinic. One of the executives made the decision they wanted to close it down and not see kids with Down syndrome anymore in the hospital. And so, you know, we had no choice, but my husband and I, but to gather some families together to fight against that, right? To go to the media, to share stories, to get in the legislature, to have petitions, to do all those things that we do. But in that, I had a conflict of interest, of course, and I had to quit my job before I could embark on that advocacy. And so, you know, I do understand why, you know, we ask for whistleblowers. We ask for those people instead of the doctors to speak up with us, the social workers, but they're scared of losing their jobs. Right, and that is a real fear. I think particularly in Canada, where we're supposed to pretend everything's nice, everyone's getting along, like this speaking up notion, like culturally in Canada is not encouraged in any way, shape or form.
Right.
So I think there can be professional, and I know I've lost, you know, speaking engagements and workshop opportunities and stuff because I'm either too much of a big mouth or people want me to speak up more. It's like, I can't even figure out what exactly, it doesn't matter what I do. I can't win. So you might as well do what's best for you because see, right. There I am trying to please people again, because you're not going to please everybody.
Yeah. You know, Sarah Kaplan in the chat has said, in a world where caregivers are recognized, our advocacy would be seen as a professional consultation. And that is a beautiful concept, where we would be sought out, where our experiences and our stories would be sought out and meaningfully contributing to healthcare change and improvement.
Yeah.
And Sharon Anderson says, you know, I think is reflecting so much of what we so often all feel. And she says, I always say I hate having to go cap in hand to ask on behalf of my husband. I feel like the child in the Dickens story, please, sir, can I have a cookie? Yeah, you know, it's true. Often we do feel somehow so uncomfortable with this role, this necessary role to get what it is that the people we love need. And I always say to myself, if I have those Dickensian feelings of please, sir, may I have some more, you know, I always tell myself, like, sternly, I am not asking for gold jewelry. I'm asking for what my loved one needs. And I have a strict talk with myself, like, it's not gold jewelry. Yeah. It's not something frivolous that I simply would choose to have for my own on a whim. It's not, it's necessary. So I think sometimes we do need to tell ourselves these things. But I'm very interested, Maggie, in preparing for today. You and I talked about this idea that you mentioned, Sue, of people. What do people do if advocacy is truly not in their nature? How on earth are they going to survive as caregivers, and what the heck are their loved ones going to be faced with? Because I don't think that advocacy is an option in the caregiver role. But then this brings me to, I would love to hear what you both think about what can we do for each other in this regard? How can we help the shy ones? How can we help the people who are just sick at the thought of confrontation? Yeah.
You know, I think I shared it with you, Donna, that my sister has frequently said since her experience that she thanks God it was her that got sick and not me, because she would not have been able, in her opinion, she would not have been able to make the demands that I made of the system or of her physicians or. And, you know, I want to remind people, more often than not, the healthcare providers that we interact with want to help. Mm-hmm. It's the system that's a problem. We're dealing with a system that's not created and not shaped in a way that meets the needs of caregivers and patients. So there's as much frustration on the part of, you know, nurses and physicians. I think one of the things that I've learned over time is how important it is to identify your tribe, you know, and understand the importance of relationship in advocacy and in what you do. And part of that relationship is, if I don't have the wherewithal, either because I'm exhausted or it's not in my wheelhouse or whatever it might be, that I have a tribe around me that can help me to do those things that I can't do. You know, I know we talked about falling into advocacy. And I know that for me, that falling into advocacy partly happened out of sheer hitting the wall and not knowing what to do when Trish was in the ICU. And I was so my wit's end and frustrated and just didn't know where to turn. And I knew in my heart of hearts that I had insights to share that would help her care. And I didn't know how to get it across. So I took to Twitter, just because I don't know why I took to Twitter, I did. And for me, what surfaced was a community of caregivers who were there to say, have you thought of this? And perhaps try that. And move a chair, get them to move a chair into your room and do this and do that. And that community of allyship, as trite as it might sound, has been an absolute lifeline to me, not just in that moment of crisis, but as I have developed as an advocate and as that journey has gone on, it has reminded me of the importance of lifting each other up. It has reminded me of the importance of mentoring each other. And so for those who are perhaps new to being an advocate or new to being a caregiver and feeling out where they need to develop advocacy skills, having mentors in a community of advocates is so important.
Yes. Oh, yes, 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 yes. And, you know, online support is incredible for people. Many of, you know, just friends who are here today, new friends, old friends listening, are people that I have supported and from whom I have received support. Most of them I have never met in person. I have a friend called Rose who lives in Fullerton, California, whom I met in the very first online bulletin board of parents of children with disabilities from Mass General Hospital. Is called Brain Talk Communities. It's the very first one. It was even before Exceptional Parent Magazine. Like, and I have known Rose for over, well, Nicholas is 33, and I'm gonna say maybe 30 years I have known. Rose brought up both her children who lived into the 50s at home without help. With her husband, both her sons have passed away from an undiagnosed genetic progressive disability. Her husband died of lung cancer last year. And Rose and I send Christmas gifts to each other. We phone each other. We write to each other. I've never met her. And I love her. I loved her, Michael, and her Jonathan.
Yeah.
And her dear Jim, her husband. The power of another caregiver is just profound, I think. Yeah. And we can find each other on social media. And, you know, people are talking in the chat about social media as well in itself. Collectively, together, we can advocate for the system change that we need and want to see. You know, so I do encourage everyone here to explore social media as a personal tool to give and receive mentoring in advocacy and just in caring generally, but also that you know, we can support each other and make friends. Yeah. Befriending each other, I think, is so important. I'm interested in the advocacy wins, and I don't want to go away today without talking about some of the big wins. You know, I'm reading in the chat box, Pamela Librelesso is here today, and she's saying that Twitter certainly upped her advocacy game and helped her to develop more of a community for herself, and in turn able to create community for others. And for sure, Pamela has had a massive advocacy win with the Ontario Human Rights Commission around her son's right to have his parents visit him as essential family caregivers during the pandemic. You know, so Maggie and Sue, what have been your wins? When you think of an advocacy win, what first comes to mind? Maggie, I'll ask you first.
So I'm going to say, first of all, what comes to mind is how people think. So an advocacy win for me is when people recognize the importance of kindness and empathy and the words we use because of the way we have advocated. So I think that's a win for me. I think I'm going to back up a little bit, Donna, because one of the things I wanted to speak about when we were talking about some of the tips is it's really important for people to recognize how vulnerable you are when you share your stories and when you advocate, and be prepared for that.
Yeah.
I know that the first time I spoke publicly about the situation with my sister, I was an emotional wreck and I had not been prepared for it. Oh. I hadn't been prepared for the reopening of wounds. I hadn't been prepared for the trauma that it brings. And so and every time I tell the story, it still scalds my heart anew. It still affects me.
Yeah.
But recognizing that we do it for a purpose, we don't do it to tick an emotional checkbox. Mm-hmm. We do it to achieve something in terms mm-hmm. of change, and whether that's change for a person or change for a system. The reason we tell those stories and open those wounds is to achieve something together. Mm-hmm. So, you know, when I think about wins, I'm going to tell you a story about a win, which is going to sound like a really silly little win, but it was a big deal for us. When my sister started, she has two cancers, started with a breast cancer diagnosis that threw her into a whole other world that she's a teacher. It was a whole other world for her. And one of the things when I went with her for her first appointment after her mammogram, this is going to sound like the silliest of things. We were sent to the cancer clinic and she had not actually received a diagnosis of cancer at the time. But the fact that we were sent to the cancer clinic and she already had a pre-made card, plastic card up, her was a sign that this is a done deal and no one has even told me that I have cancer. I've just been sent to the, so I went afterwards to the CEO of the hospital mm-hmm. and said, have you ever thought about where you're telling people this diagnosis and how? She had an appointment to go to the cancer center, had a pre-made plastic ID card as a cancer patient, and no one had yet shared with her that was diagnosis. Mm-hmm. So could we back it up a step? And I know it may not be as efficient in terms of, you know, your flow in the clinics, but it's important. Mm-hmm. So they did that. And it was sort of a small A advocacy, but it was a big win, I think. And I know that they still do it today. And then when I think of other things that we've done that I think change how people experience care. You know, one of the hardest things for my sister's journey was when she was a hallway patient mm-hmm. And had a nurse who was exhausted, absolutely exhausted, yell across the ward and ask another one of her colleagues to check the vaginal drain in hallway slot four. She didn't have a name, she didn't have any dignity, and she is an intensely violent person. Mm-hmm. And again, I went afterwards to the patient engagement office and said, no one meant harm, but how difficult would it be, and I will help you design it, to find a way to put someone's name in the hallway. You know, yes, they're there transiently, but there's got to be a way that we can remember their humanity. So those things, you know, while they're small and they're localized to an individual institution, I know they made a difference for my sister, knowing that they've happened. But I hope they make a difference for others who've come along after her.
Yeah, absolutely. Those are very, very, very moving stories, Maggie. And it reminds me how much advocacy is about the fact that you are the only person who really knows this individual, knows and loves this individual, and that fact dictates your role to broker the humanity of that person in this setting, which would conspire to erase the humanity of everybody for the sake of the false god of efficiencies in the healthcare world. But Sue, what are your thoughts? And can you tell us about some of your big wins? Because I know you've got many, and I will also want to just point out, Eliette is asking, where can I find the essays that we're talking about, your work?
Yeah, I do a lot of writing on my website, which is, I think somebody put it up, Nadia put it up for me, is suerobbins.com. So that, I think that was the last essay I wrote, actually. I was feeling a lot of pressure about advocating for the booster, for the third shot for my son's community. And I just thought it was important to address that, the fact that I think sometimes we get a lot of pressure to just, you know, rev up a campaign, like go, you know, write your MLAs, go in the media and talk about your story, like, and really how much, I mean, I can't do those more than once a year, like how much that takes out of you and your family and our son, you know, when we're asked to do this really big sky, blue sky advocacy that we sometimes get asked to do if we're big mouth. I don't want to say a leader, I just say somebody who's willing to speak up in the community. But kind of that one aside, I think I just want to go back to Maggie's dad. I just saw the movie Belfast and it was so wonderful. And it reminded me how the Irish are such great storytellers. If you ever get a chance to see an Irish movie, like really, like just to watch the way that the story is told and unfolds and how important it is for us caregivers to understand how to tell our stories. Yes. And to help the people we're caring for also tell their stories in their own way. Mm-hmm. And this is something that I'm really, really big on. And when I worked at the Stollard Children's Hospital, I was very lucky to coach families to help them share their stories, you know, at grand rounds, at nursing orientation, so that health professionals could understand and have compassion for the way it feels to be a family in the hospital. And I think that that's the real key. And understanding your why you're telling your story, I think, is really important. And I talk a lot about this. And if you had asked me a few years ago, I'd say, well, I share my story as my son's mom to make a difference. I want to make a difference. And what I really challenge people to do is to dig deeper than that, because I think it's something always very personal why you share your story. And what I realized, this is how I know one day I made a little bit of a change by sharing my story. I talked to a group of staff who worked in the NICU, in the NICU, and we were talking about disclosing diagnosis. And lots of babies with Down syndrome do end up in the NICU, and that's where the families find out their baby might have Down syndrome. So, and what I said to them, instead of saying, when you meet a new family who might have a baby with Down syndrome, instead of saying, I'm sorry, why don't you say congratulations? Because a baby has been born. And I realized that is my why. Anytime I talk about being Aaron's mom, I want to talk about celebration, not tragedy. Like I want to, because what happens is that joy is taken from those families. And
that's not inauthentic joy.
No, like a baby has been born.
Brokering our loved ones to the world.
Right. And they'd never thought of it. The social worker actually thought, I'm sorry, like your baby has Down syndrome, they're in the NICU, I'm so sorry. But what us families hear is, I'm sorry your baby has been born. Like, that's what we hear. So, but unless I had that chance to share the story to her in a way that she understood, she had never thought of it before. So I ran into her a couple of weeks later in the hallway, and she came up to me and she said, you know, you said say congratulations first. She's like, I don't know. Like, that's not the way she did things, right? So, you know, that I love health professionals, but they're very habitual and they're, you know, they like their
routines. They have their training.
Yes. And she said, I thought I'd try it. I just thought I'd try it. So the next family I met in the NICU who had a baby with Down syndrome, I said to them, I opened with congratulations. And she said it totally changed their relationship. Because she was starting from a place of strength as opposed to some deficit base. And so I realized, you know, I just think we do so much public speaking, sharing our stories, even at the bedside, sharing our stories. And we never really know if we've made any kind of difference. That's the problem. We don't know when we've really had a win, especially if we're talking about system change. And that in itself can be very frustrating. And the one thing I wanted to make sure I said about point of care is that it's okay. You know, I think about Aaron, and I was very good at speaking up for him. But when I myself got breast cancer, I was like, I was not an advocate. I was like the smallest, most fragile person in the room. Yeah. Everyone's like, oh, you know how to be a good advocate because you've done that for your son. When it happened to me, I was like so meek and vulnerable and I would afraid I was going to die. And I was like this small, even though I have all these skills, but there was something about it being about me personally that I was not able to speak up for myself. And what I want to say to everybody on this call is please give yourself some grace. Oh my God. There's so many times when I haven't spoken up, I often write about it afterwards. That's how I process things.
Me too.
Or I'll contact people. Cause you know how you don't think of the right thing to say in the moment, but then when you get home, you're like, damn. And so I will follow up afterwards. But in that moment, there were many, many times when I should have spoken up and I just couldn't. And, you know, be forgiving. And, you know, one thing as caregivers are not very good at is self-compassion. I'm not talking about self-care. I'm talking about being compassionate for ourselves, because we cannot always be speaking up all the time.
No, we cannot. you know, I want to, I know we're drawing to an end, and we have, a few really important news and announcements that we want to share at the end as well. You know, I just really, really want to thank you guys so much for chatting with us today. And I know that there's a lot of very moving comments in the chat. You know, and I know that there are some people who are new to caregiving who are listening today and maybe thinking about advocacy, the risks and the benefits of speaking up, even when it's hard and uncomfortable and risky. You know, I think sometimes it is very challenging. And I guess I would like to leave by asking you both, if there's a question, if there's one question you could ask yourself that could be the pivotal question that would help you decide whether you should say something that you're feeling, what would that question be? And just to give you a second to think about that, maybe it would be something like, if I were the patient here, would I want my loved one to speak up about this? How am I going to feel tomorrow if I don't say anything? What is that question that you ask yourself that can help you decide, I need to say something. I cannot stay silent. Have you got any ideas about that? Or do you remember asking yourself, like...
You're ending on a hard question, Donna. Holy moly.
Yeah, it's a really tough question.
I think So one thing I learned when I was a patient myself that my friend Isabel Jordan taught me, because I was explaining to her how small I felt, like, and I met Isabel on Twitter, by the way, is that she said, when you walk into that hospital, you should think you are the queen, she says, and not in a way where you're like demanding things, and not in that way, because I was like this, but like, it helped give me the confidence to walk in, to say like, and I think some of it has to do with our own feelings about how much value and worth we have as human beings. And believe me, there's lots of power in healthcare, and they'll lord over you with all their power. And so this idea of me thinking that I am the queen, I have a right to decent care. It's like a basic human right. I have a right to speak up, like all that kind of thing. I think I did that a few times when I went in for my radiation treatment, and it did actually make me feel more confident. So I think that sometimes anything that we can do to make ourselves feel confident, even if it's a little mantra, I think can be actually quite helpful. So that was helpful for me, that I was the queen when I went in for cancer treatment. And even if I only kept that in my head, it certainly helped me feel a lot better.
That's fantastic. That's exactly what I was hoping you'd share something like that.
For me, Donna, it's a matter of it's less about a question and reminding myself on each and every encounter that I am part of the care team. Mm-hmm. And they may not know it yet, but I am part of the care team. And as part of the care team, I will use my voice. And like I said, again, for me, part of the mantra is with what happened with my dad, where I made a commitment to myself that I would never let my voice be silenced again.
I would, for myself, I sometimes think if I'm sort of looking for I'm trying to help myself make the decision to speak, I will ask myself, if the care providers knew what I want to tell them, would my son or my mom's care be better? Do I believe they want to give care and would want to know what's in my mind? Wouldn't they appreciate knowing more so they could do better? And sometimes I think I go on these mental scenarios and I build up a story for myself that makes it okay for me to speak up, because I've got these reasons that are all going to be better if I speak. So what a fun and interesting conversation. And I just want to thank you both so much. And we're going to continue. We have monthly webinars, and I invite you all to come back again and again, because this is where we make friends and we talk about what is most important and most personal in our caring lives. So thank you, Maggie, so much, and Sue, and everybody, buy Sue Robbins, both her books, Bird's Eye View, and her new book, Ducks in a Row. It's all about how we need to reinvent our healthcare systems and insert kindness and compassion that has all been engineered out of many systems of care. So I'm just so grateful to have had this conversation today. Thank you. And thank you all for listening. But keep listening, because there's news and announcements, and I'm going to hand it back over to Erin. Thank you.
Thanks, Donna, Maggie, and Sue. And thank you, everyone, so much for joining the webinar and participating in the chat today. It was a very moving, warm, and incredible conversation just for me to listen in on. And that is it for our webinar today. Thanks again, everyone, and I hope you have a lovely day.